sound? Okay. I don't like so much because there are people hidden by my screen, and I think it's not good for interaction.
You want me to do a ladder?
No, no, it's okay.
Let me tell you a few words. Okay. Thank you for coming. Good morning, everybody. Today, Maurice Benayoun, we all know who he is, and coming from very far away from Hong Kong to collaborate with us and our department, the Ionian University, the Audiovisual Arts Department. He comes from Hong Kong. He is going to, as a keynote speaker, he's going to talk to us about the end of the end of art in logic and computer engineering. Two negations means one positive thing. So I reckon it's going to be aisiodoxo, as we say in Greek, a message from you. Maurice Benayoun, thank you for coming. We are here to listen to your talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Nicolas. I'm very glad to be here. It's my first time in Corfu, and it's a kind of magic place, and I'm very excited, and people are very nice, so that's great. I prepared this talk in a very specific way. I'm expecting some interaction, so you can stop me whenever you want. If you want to say something, if you want to comment, if you want to ask questions. It's not a talk that I have already given before, so let's see. I'm trying this concept with this quite important to me, and I think it's quite clear at the end of art, somebody told me, oh yeah, that means the beginning. Okay, so let's see if it's about the beginning of art. It's interesting to see, for those people who experienced the last 30 years of media art, I think it was really fascinating to see how the contemporary art world was allergic to any kind of media practice. For different reasons, and one of them is the computer, the machine, everything that is supposed to belong to the realm of technology, industry, and Big Brother. Things evolved, of course, and this last decade, everybody got used to technologies, and now it becomes obviously part of society. It doesn't mean we have to, we don't have to be careful. It doesn't mean we don't have to pay attention of the negative consequences. The question was posed in a very interesting way by Lev Manovich in 96. And he decided to create two opposite camps. One was Duchamp land, the one made of the what some people would have called the art world, with galleries, major museums, prestigious art journals, and on the model of Disneyland, but it's just the wording, which is referring to Disneyland. It's not the way to characterize Duchamp land. And the other one would be made of events like IZEA, Ars Electronica, SIGGRAPH, and so on. And for, according to Lev Manovich, we should call it Turing land. And I don't know why, decided to write this. What we should not expect from Turing land is art which will be accepted in Duchamp land. Duchamp land wants art, not research into new aesthetic possibilities of new media. The convergence will not happen. Interesting. say that. So let's talk about Turing Land. And so I guess this event is part of Turing Land. So according to Manovich, it's very easy to recognize the features and the properties of both fields, both lands. Duchamp Land is content-centered. It's complicated. It's ironic. When Turing Land is looking for the new, simple, and serious. I thought that's a very interesting exercise of characterization and taxonomy of both fields, and I wanted to check. Duchamp Land, is it content-centered? Is this complicated? Is this ironic? Turing Land, is this new, to write into with Gothic characters, even if it's with a robot? Is bio art simple? Is, for example, this work by Miltos Manitas serious? What we can easily spot is that we cannot divide practices with these criteria, and they don't make a specific differentiation between two fields, because obviously they seem to have all these properties and maybe to separate, to divide their conception of art along different axes. And so the line between Duchamp and Turing is probably not this one. Is there a line between contemporary art and media art, if we talk in terms of serious and funny, I don't know, ironic? I'm not sure. Complexity and simplicity, I'm not sure. Maybe there are other lines that divide different kind of practice in the art field. And so, all the lines that has been created in the art world for the 20th century, we could illustrate the emergence of divisions by exploring certain a limited number of references. And I thought so limited that we will limit it to Duchamp. Actually, the Duchamp brothers. So I thought to understand what divide different approaches in the 20th century, and mostly in the relation between art and science, the relation between art and existing practices, we could take the example of the Duchamp brothers. Of course, you're familiar with Marcel. You know Jacques Villon. And of course, Raymond Duchamp Villon. I don't know the name of the dog. But actually, there is also a sister. And so if there were six brothers and sisters, four of them were artists. So we have also Suzanne Duchamp. Suzanne Duchamp combined mathematics, geometry, colors, color text, and so on, in search of a kind of new alchemy in the art world. This is the kind of thing she produced. She didn't produce a lot, so it's difficult to see what she would have done. We see some influence by some friends like Francis Picabien. And we see the will not to create a unification of the representation space, but to put together things that belong to different the registry of representation. Jacques Villon, how many of you know Jacques Villon, artist? It's a very interesting artist. Actually, he was fascinated by science, and he thought that science could help in finding rules for harmony. So he was one of the founders of La Section d'Or, looking for codes, keys, models, references, geometry, colors, and so on. So this is a kind of thing they were exploring at this time, trying to find a real way, scientific way, to create harmonious compositions. So it's about the science and mathematics applied to art. And they were fascinated by the Tratto della Pittura di Leonardo da Vinci by Joséphin Péladan, who was a kind of guru of the time. Raymond Duchamp-Villon was trying something different in the relation between science and art. And he tried to create the fusion of nature and technology through traditional media. You probably know this sculpture called the horse. Of course, it's made with a very traditional medium. It's not trying to use technology, but it's trying to use classic practices in order to represent something of the time. And this was, of course, the locomotive, the mechanics. There were not the robotics yet, but we understand that this horse is a steam horse, is actually already a machine, it should be. And Marcel Duchamp. So it's interesting because everybody is focusing on the idea that Marcel Duchamp would be at the origin of the model, the reference in contemporary art. But I'm not sure that he has been understood exactly for what he was doing and what was specific in its approach. So its main heritage is stay open. Nothing more, but nothing less. That means don't believe that all your life you will use the same medium. Don't think you will create what you create the same way, and you will consider the world and the art world the same way. So you have to keep moving. And so what Duchamp expressed was the experience of freedom in art, constantly shifting boundaries and redefining art by each new work. Very different from what the Brussels were doing at this time. For example, let's pick a few examples. The so-called nude descending the staircase in 1940, it's about motion, and we know with the Futurist and many other artists at this time, they were fascinated by chronophotography and Marais and Muybridge. Stoppage étalon. It's a different shape of 1 meter long when you have a string and a thread and you let it fall on the ground and you say, this is 1 meter. So you create as a conceptual project, different things that are supposed to be 1 meter, but taking care of the law of gravity. Fontaine. It's about ontology of art. Ontology, what art is, what it should be, what should it be, what an artwork is, what they can remove from an artwork and it's still an artwork, like craftsmanship and all these things. Élevage de poussière, growing dust. It's about the process, some things that will evolve in time and create something that you cannot consider as a definitive, completed artwork, but that will accept this evolution as considering constituting the major feature. So the price rate by our bachelors, even, I'm sure the translation is very difficult of this, and I don't like this translation, but this is the official one. It's about narratives. How you tell a story? If you're not using words, if it's not cinema, if it's not theater play. Paysage fautif. That means guilty landscape. Sperm on satin. It's bio art, of course. Disque rotorelief. This is op art. Étant donné la chute d'eau, le gaz d'éclairage. You know, this one is considered as the first ever art installation made by putting together elements distributed in space in a way that you discover it and you the meaning has to come from the experience of watching something which is three-dimensional. So for me, there are different ways for them to consider the relation between science and art, the relation between art and what it should become at a time when people were thinking about the future of art. So Jacques Villon was considering science as a tool. Raymond Duchamp-Villon was considering science as a topic. Marcel Duchamp was created what I call open media art, opening the medium, considering we shouldn't focus on one specific medium and we should consider exploring other ways of saying things. This had, of course, different impacts. In a way, this is a time when the curator artist came. For a simple reason, the artist acting like a curator, that means selecting an object that should be displayed, is actually doing the curator's job. So, Hermut from the urinal, the fountain, is a fictional artist. Duchamp curated the work. He was part of the committee of the independent exhibition, and he proposed this work. And the work, of course, was not accepted. So Duchamp didn't create the object. He didn't build the urinal. He didn't create the artwork. So maybe, let's see why I say that. Oh, sorry, this is not expected. So this is Fontaine. What if Fontaine would be the first example of appropriation art? I introduce some of you, because I guess some others already know, the Baroness Elsa von Freytag-Loringhoven. It's important to know her. This is a work she did in 1918 called God. She was working a lot with pieces of plumbing. And this is a story. More and more people now admit that Duchamp never pretended he made the urinal. He did pretend that in the 40s. Not when he submitted it. He was part of the committee. So he didn't submit something. It was submitted in the name of Richard Mutt. Later he said he bought it in a shop, Mutt, M-O-T-T, but in this shop they never had this model. 2 days after the work has been excluded, had been dismissed by the committee, he wrote to his sister Suzanne, and he said, "A friend of mine, a woman, gave me a urinal, signed it Ahmed, and I submitted it to the committee, who said no." So it's weird, because it seemed that he really, I haven't seen the letter, but I'm not talking about something that is not well known, so you can check online. This is very well spread. And it's not a conspiracy theory, because she was a kind of a égérie of the time, and she was well known in the New York of the 20s, on the 10s and 20s. She died young, in 27. And at this time, she was already back in Germany, back to Germany. So let's talk about the end of art. The previous one, I was showing that because I wanted you to understand how certain mutation in the art field happen. And in a way, Duchamp made possible the fact that the curator can say, if an artist can do it, I can be an artist. And so the curator becoming an artist, this changes a lot of things, because then the artist has to think about what is supposed to be his job or her job. So Danto explained that we could talk about the end of art with the end of the master narrative base of mimesis. I'm not sure he explained that, but clearly this happened with the emergence of photography in the 19th century. Suddenly, artists had to find something else that just based their work on mimesis. This is how we came with the idea that we should get rid of representation and work on presentation. And this is why Duchamp and Warhol did that. It doesn't mean they did that all their life. So the presentation of the work, like presenting the urinal without doing the urinal, is a way to dissociate the know-how from the artifact. Oh, it's not because I know ceramics that I'm doing, that I'm exhibiting a urinal, you know? It's something different. So we separate craftsmanship from concept. I have a good idea, I don't have to be able to do it, I have to do it. And this is how appeared in art history in the 20th century, the object like that, that could be considered as extension of the ready-made from Duchamp. And the interesting thing, this is actually what we could call the second end of art. The second end of art, because if the first one is the end of mimesis as a master narrative, the second one is the fact that maybe we don't need even to do the work. We just have to, we don't have it even to design the work. We just can take something that exists. And so the neutralization of the craftsmanship allow to go from the classic structure, artist, medium, artwork, to another structure, curator, artist as a medium, and exhibition. The exhibition becoming the artwork, the artist becoming the medium, and the curator becoming the artist. So, what could be called the second end of art is probably the late ready-made. Not the first one. The first one was, in a way, a revolution, changing something in depth. But the second one made just impossible the evolution in the genre. What can we do more than a ready-made if it's not another ready-made? We cannot improve the ready-made like we could improve our way of painting a great nude. A ready-made is a ready-made. So, in a way, it's a dead end. would say also there is a third end of art. And of course we could list plenty of end of arts in the 20th century. When Dante wrote The Transfiguration of the Commonplace, in a way he opened the door to what was already started with the Dadaists, which is the idea of artification of life, to make one's life a piece of art. And we could understand, if your life is a piece of art, you don't need to produce any kind of object that you would call artwork. But the other possibility, on the other hand, is actually the banalization of art, to make art a piece of life. And in a way, we see more and more of that. Oh, looks like life. Okay. So many ends. Conceptual art, and I consider my work as conceptual, it reduces the artwork to its definition. So maybe it's another limitation because there is no possibility of going forward in that direction. So maybe it's another dead end. Postmodernism, you know, this is when I finished, if we can finish, my studies in art. It was in the beginning of the 80s, and at this time everybody was talking about going back to painting. And it was even called bad painting. It was called a kind of a neo-expressionism. It was called figuration libre, and all kind of way to go back to the past and do what other people have done, maybe in another way, but not so different in a way. Honestly, I was really bored. I thought, wow, is it the perspective that we have? Is it what we can do? And so, actually, the reason for this is that art is about the relation to the world, our relation to the world, how we interpret it, how we see it, how we want to act on it. And in a way, we could say that the least, the series of specific relations to the world that are not based on survival, I'm talking about, I don't know, religion, science, philosophy, and art, are actually a way to make the world understandable or acceptable. And this, of course, can lead us to experience different things. Oh, what if the world or nature or people or their behavior would be enough? What if we get rid of artifacts, cosmetics, colors, things added to the world? Would it be a good way to find exactly what the world is about? Of course, with the limitation that if this is what the world is about, this doesn't help understanding the world. So, then something changed around the 80s, mostly 70s, 80s, and more, of course, after. It's actually the fact that some technologies arrived and they changed the nature of the relation between people and the relation between these people and the world. So this is what trades used to be before the digital. You could recognize the painter by the way the painter is dressed. You could recognize a plumber, a photographer, because of the specific tools, equipments, attitude. But now things have changed, and we know that. So this is a writer, a scientist, an accountant, a philosopher, an architect, composer. The tools have become the media. And actually, we can access to all these tools, and we can even learn them with exactly the same medium, the same interface, either a keyboard or something that looks like a keyboard or a mouse, or trackpad or whatever. To take a very specific example, so you see robotic arms on a car assembly line. They make cars with Stellarc. It's an artwork. Here is surgery. The same tools can be used for very different trades, very different professions, and very different activities. But of course, when we talk about the kind of McLuhanian vision, which is not original, it's also an extension of the brain, as you can see here. So, what is my point? My point is the following. What time is it? I told you it's very flexible, my slides, so I have to know exactly how long I have. Okay, so I wanted to take a few examples in my practice, because otherwise you will wonder, yes, why this guy comes to talk here. And just to explain how I try to use sometimes technologies in order to explore the potential of action of the world. Because the big change is probably the fact that now, instead of playing the world like an artwork or art as the world, we can also, with art, act on the world at different levels. Sometimes very limited, sometimes it's okay. So in the early 90s, I made a 3D computer graphic series called Quarks. And it's one of the very, very, very first TV series. But my challenge, I don't know, my challenge was to have this on prime time on TV and to put something that for me was, in a way, a conceptual work about representation and about truth in science. And so I wanted it to be in prime time, to be broadcast in prime time, and that it was broadcast in prime time. So in a way, I have the feeling that I succeeded in what I wanted to do. And this was also seen by, it was seen by many people, I mean millions. And I thought this is one of the things we can do with technologies. We can access a lot of people, what artists couldn't do so far. But the problem I have was actually that pre-rendered animation doesn't offer one of the properties of the real, which is virtuality. And we have to be clear, I'm not talking about virtual reality, I'm talking about virtuality. Virtual reality is a technique, is a technology to make a certain kind of representation. And virtuality is a property of reality. And this property, of course, is very important because at this time, it has become possible to apply it to art practice. And so we can consider in a way that virtuality is a required condition of the world as we know it. To be clear about that, just imagine that I remove virtuality from the world. I think we would get stuck before the Big Bang, because if the particles didn't have any virtuality, they couldn't evolve, nothing would happen. And we wouldn't be here to talk about that. But what interested me after doing the Quarks was the idea of using virtuality as a medium for art, considering that as soon as we could, in the representation, introduce this property of the real, which is the virtuality, then this should become the medium. Of course, VR is using virtuality. And I first started, if I work with VR, should the world be full or empty? Because everything in the VR world is something you decide. And so this work, it was done in 94, it's got flat, and it's a world full of bricks. And when we move in it, it creates corridors, whatever the direction. And if we are lucky, we find images floating in this space. There are images of gods coming from the artistry. And of course, it's a metaphor of life. So it's all about your objectives. Some people collect images. Some people just try to modify their living space, vital space. Because there is no exit in this space. This is the first time I used a neural network in 94 also. And this is a second of the series, a big question. It's called, is the devil curved? And in the sky, there is a living thing made of five spheres that try to seduce us. Actually, this thing, totally autonomous, is exactly like a primetime TV program trying to seduce the audience by saying, oh, I love you, stay with me. I love you. But actually, if you are not motivated by this shape, you go away, another one will come with a different combination of spheres until the system finds the best one to seduce you. And this was presented on a TV channel booth at Imagina in 94. Beginning of 95, sorry. So that's when you dig a lot, you see the map. The same year, I was asked to create something between Montreal, the Museum of Contemporary Art in Montreal, and the Centre Pompidou in Paris. It was a tunnel under the Atlantic. So at the top, it's Montreal, and bottom, it's the Pompidou Center in Paris. And both sides, people were digging into a cultural material that was supposed to be an obstacle to communication. And they took 5 days to meet, but they didn't know it would be 5 days. And if you dig a lot, you create big caves like that that are the result of your experience of digging. And the voice tells you where to go to meet the other one. So just imagine 95 was, of course, the beginning of the web. Very beginning. So this was VR connected between two continents, and of course you could meet the other not only by the voice, but because you could also see the other through video inside the VR world. So this is how the video is inserted in. And this is the first meeting after 5 days of digging. People who used to come 2 hours a day. Every day. Mathieu, we can see you in Montreal. I can see you. You're dressed in red with a white collar. As you can see, after 5 days, I have nothing special to say. And this is what we call, in theory, communication theory, the fatigue dimension of communication. Tunnel around the world, it's years later, 2016, no, okay. Just to show you some students interacting with this piece that was between San Jose in California, 01, Biennial Media City Seoul, Biennial in Seoul, SAT in Montreal, and Hong Kong, the School of Creative Media. And this was actually the economy recommender engine I was mentioning before, which select the images according to how people behave in front of them. But that this was also a way to meet the people on the other side. And I didn't say anything to the student. I just told them, oh, just interact. You have to make a video. And the interesting thing is whatever they do, they did, it worked. I have no more time for this. For the 20 years of the tunnel under the Atlantic, we did this show in Hong Kong with kind of elephant skeletons, the dead tunnels, but actually there were new tunnels with also the video of the original one. So this one is a Borders tunnel where you could dig through images related to borders. And this one is a Colors tunnel where you dig in colors, no time to tell you. Crossing talks, no time. World Skin, just because it's a classic. Photos that are in the end of war, 97. This is a kind of situation where you can ask questions and put people in situations so that become interesting. So you tell them they will visit a virtual reality world and they have photo cameras and so they can make photos, can take photos. So the world is made of 2D photos, cutouts, in a landscape. The photos are coming from the Second World War and the Bosnia War. And so when the public take photos, whatever they take is removed from the scene, it's wiped out, and it's printed out. So they can take the paper representation of the scene, but this is not anymore part of the 3D landscape. Of course, I don't say that when they start. So you see the group inside the cave. We call that a cave, historically speaking. So it's a VR cube. But it doesn't look like wallpaper because you have stereoscopic glasses, so it's space is open around you. And you see your body and you can see the others, so it's a group experience. And the sound made by Jean-Baptiste Barrière evolved, and the camera trigger sound becomes a gun sound. This is the kind of photo people got. So this is what I did for the Arc de Triomphe in Paris, about war and peace, but it's too long. Augmented reality telescope. This is a work about collective retinal memory. The idea that we could share the experience of watching here artworks, and in the next one, Cosmopolis in 2005, four cities in China where people had the possibility to see panoramas of all around the world, 12 different cities. So this is the global thing with 12 screens and 12 telescopes, and the telescope has been built for that because they didn't exist at this time. They still don't exist. When you look with the telescope to this kind of panorama that were not tourist panorama, but were panoramas about how city evolves and why they evolve that way. So this is Shanghai, but you have also Chicago, Soweto, Cairo, São Paulo, Paris, Berlin, Hong Kong, Shanghai, Chongqing, Chengdu. And the principle of the collective retinal memory is, okay, I don't know why this is talking. Ah, okay, it's a video. So you see the real thing with the collective retinal memory here. And this is before it went to Shanghai. So it was in France just before the sending it. And you see the people in action with the light on them. And this was in Shanghai where we got something like more than 10,000 people every day coming. It was the biggest show at this time. And this is the audience, that's totally magic. They come, it's a family experience. So they come with that. And this is a Three Gorge Museum in Chongqing where it was the opening exhibition of the museum. So this is the opening. And so this is people in action. this one, and maybe I will stop with that. I think I'm close to the end. Let me make it short. So people are converted into flash codes, and these flash codes then are paving the ID city, and they become the buildings. It's all about the relation between the inhabitants, the people making the buildings, what is a city, what is the definition of the city, and what should be the place of the people who make the building, because those, of course, never live in the building they build. And this is a series of mechanics of emotions with works in Paris. So that this is emotion forecast, where I present, like a weather forecast, the emotion of the world, 3,200 cities. And this was in New York. Occupy Wall Screens. And this is in Seoul. I thought I had a video, and this is okay. During 2 years and a half, I've created a program called Open Sky Gallery, Open Sky Project, and artists and my MFA students had the possibility to do something on the biggest screen in the world, which is 70,000 square meters. And so during 2 hours and a half every night, and they had their work presented. And Jim Campbell, this one, very well known, which is swimmers going up and down on the tower during 1 month. Okay, that was the most important point, but I'm a bit short. I know I'm already longer than the time. Okay, we can stop here, and I just leave the video running. It's about reification and sublimation, but this will be for the next time. But I let the video because there is no text on it, so I can remove. And it's about using EEG to control matter and to give shape to human abstractions that become objects, so reified. Things like peace, love, freedom, hate, power, money are converted into object by thinking. So, I don't know if you have a few questions, maybe one question, two. I don't know.
I would like first to thank you for the offering. I mean it, by the way, that it's a very interesting optical essay, the way Abi Warburg made his own Mnemosyne a long time ago. Five or four paradox pairs like this that compare between Marcel Duchamp and Alan Turing come in my mind if you want to make a little comment on this. First of all, I think that there is Guy Debord and Peter Birger, the man who wrote The Death of the Avant-Garde, something like this. The other is Wolfgang Streeck. Wolfgang Streeck is the successor of Jürgen Habermas in the Max Planck Institute. He wrote a book recently about how capitalism will end, The Death of a Failing System. And the other name who comes in mind with this is Arthur Dunn, of course, with anything it goes. And of course, I want to mention something about these peculiarities of predicting images, let's say this, of Marcel Duchamp. Marcel Duchamp made this a tandone, you know very well about this work. Alan Turing suffered very painful end of his life, you know, from this chemical castration, as you may already that. I think that there is an interconnection. The last thing I want to say about this is that, how can we say, one of the possibility to see what is coming after the end of the art, like Serge Guibaud book, I think you are familiar with this. He wrote this, a French academic, a very interesting book about how did New York stole the modernism idea from Paris, from Paris. I think that we might write again a new book, how Hong Kong stole the idea of a new modernism from New York. Thank you.
I'm not sure I understood one of the person, but I think they have different points. So regarding people having written that things about the end of art, there are plenty of people. Usually I mention a lot Guy Debord when I talk about some specific topics which are related to image in the public space and so on. I didn't want to, you know, in France it has been a very strong polemics about yeah, art is dead and so on, and I didn't want this discussion. I'm more interested by the fact that some parameters, by the fact that some you hate to have the microphone here, but by the fact that some components of art has been modified by the intrusion of the contemporary media, and this is something that probably create a different context, and we cannot consider the practice exactly the same way. It doesn't mean that we are not talking about the same things. It doesn't mean that the artist's role is different. It means that we are dealing with something different, and it doesn't make sense, for example, to focus totally on the object. Maybe even if the object is supposed to be very banal object, very commonplace object. And this is this mutation that interests me, because I have the feeling that it is a kind of restart. And artists can have an impact on the world. They are working on politics, they are working on economy, they are working on society. And this is a big change, because they got another kind of reach. They can reach the world. They can address very large topics. They can find people that agree or disagree with them. And this is a big change. So people who designed, who thought about what art should be and what it has been in the 60s, the 70s, they probably didn't anticipate this this evolution. So for the second question, I'm not totally sure. So I don't know. Do you want to just to make a short version of your question? Yeah, it's a bit difficult too, because we have also the computer, the air conditioning, and all the things running.
Okay, you can discuss this later.
Okay, we can
Let's
talk
have another one from Dalila. No, who wants to have a question? Very much. We can discuss later.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you. You've been perfect.